Good morning.
Morning.
Good to be home. Good to be home. Yeah, we were in South Lake Tahoe spending a week with our kids and our grandkids, and it snowed buckets there, man. It's amazing. So in South Lake Tahoe, they got this machine. I never seen it before because, well, you know, I never lived in the snow until 8 years ago. Anyway, so they push all the snow into the center. What is that called? The center. Yeah. Anyway, and yeah, and it's a big berm. That's what it's called. A berm in the center. And then they have this machine, and it has like these two massive blades. And if you got caught by that, it would kill you, man. You'd be dog food. But anyway, so they have these two massive blades, and then this thing's going like 2 miles an hour. It's just going, and it takes the snow, and somehow miraculously it makes it like into like dust, snow dust, and it goes, and then it shoots out this little thing, a chute. Yeah, it shoots out the chute. Yeah, this is very technical explanation. This is the engineering part of the sermon. And then it goes into the dump truck, and then they go and they take it and they dump it into like parking lots. And so parking lots in South Lake Tahoe are a mess, but the roads are beautiful. Anyway, so, and then we drove home yesterday on Highway 50, and it was crazy. And so we're just glad to be home safe and sound. And now driving in the snow here is like no big deal anymore. So I'm good. Anyway, so my name is Rick, and I'm one of the pastors, and we've been in a series called This, That, and the Other. And the reason why we're doing this is that about a year ago, we started a time where the staff and the elders and the deacons and the deaconesses and their spouses got together for worship and for dinner. And we just wanted to have a time and a place that as we got bigger, that once a month we could come together and worship together and pray for the church and hear from each other. And so we have a time of worship, we have a time of prayer, we eat dinner afterwards, but right before dinner, one of the leadership, a pastor, an elder, a deacon, a deaconess, they get up and they share about what God has laid on their heart. And we thought that it would be good for you all to hear from the four of us, Randy and Steve and myself and Pastor Conrad, about what's on our heart for this new year. And so that's kind of what we've been doing. And I hope that you've been hearing what God has been saying through us, that you've been contemplating it. Maybe you heard Randy's talk, a sermon 2 weeks ago, and you thought, man, you know what? I'm kind, I'm nice, but what does it take for me to move to being generous? And how might God use my life in a way that would be generous to the people that I know in my community in the coming year? Or Pastor Steve last year talking about, you know, because we've been forgiven much, we have this great responsibility then to be involved in ministry that helps bring people to Christ. And so maybe one of those three areas that Steve highlighted at the end of the service, or maybe something else, that you might just take that next act of service, using your gifts to benefit the body, benefit our community, and saying thank you, giving back to because of what Christ has done for me. And today, it's me. And so as we, you know, are in the month of January, I get to talk about what God laid on my heart. And the great thing about being, you know, the number two is I don't have to preach that often. I love to preach, but I don't like to preach every week, man. Because, man, Pastor Conrad has to come up with something new every week. Yuck. But anyway, so the fact that I get to preach 8 times a year means I get lots of time to think about stuff. And what I have for you today really started back in March, and I'll be sharing some of that. And so God's been putting some stuff on my heart, and I've been praying about it and studying, so I'm just really excited about it. But I just want to start, before I get to my stuff, I want to talk about who we are as a church. And hopefully some of you have seen this. This is our purpose statement. Our purpose statement says this: Community Church exists to be a missional and grace-oriented church that actively seeks the lost and intentionally grows the found. And what that means is this: that we want to be about mission, and that mission is not our mission, it's the mission of Jesus Christ. We want to be about presenting the gospel of Jesus Christ, to this broken and hurting world. And through that, we want to show that God's grace is available to all of us. And I think the reason why that statement is so much a part of who we are is because of it's what God's done in your leadership's life. If you know Pastor Steve's journey, if you know Pastor Conrad's journey, if you know Pastor Floyd's journey, you know that God has shown us tremendous grace and tremendous mercy. And we're just three broken guys who somehow God has chosen to use to build a church in Lassen County. And we want to do that in two ways. One is that we want to actively seek the lost. That means that we want to be about looking for people that don't yet know and have a relationship with Jesus Christ. And we also then want to intentionally grow the found. We would hope that we as a body would help you be a closer follower of Christ in 2017 than you are today, than you were in 2016. That as you look back and you say, you know, because I've been involved in the community church for 1 year, for 3 months, for 3 years, for 33 years, I'm closer to who God has desires me to be because community church has encouraged me. They've helped me grow. And we want to be about that. And the second part of our purpose statement is this. We will accomplish this by being biblical. See, we're not going to teach what the Reader's Digest says. It doesn't. This loses some of its effect as I hold up the iPad. But Pastor Conrad has a real Bible. You know, don't clap for him. Don't clap for him. His job's way too easy. Don't clap for him. And we're gonna as we get up here and preach or teach, it's gonna be based on Scripture, not my opinion. Not my thoughts and musings. See, based on God's word. We want to be relational. And the reason why we're relational is because God's relational. Before you were a twinkle in your Father's eye, God was in relationship with God the Son, God the Father, and God the Holy Spirit. Relationship starts with the Father, and He desires for us to be relational with Him and with our world. He wants us to be authentic, to be real, to be transparent, to let people know that, you know what? What was available to me is available to you. And even though I'm a mess, sometimes a hot mess, God still welcomes you, desires you. And of course, we want to be relevant. There's a million ways to do church. Our way is not the best way. It's just a way. And we try and be relevant by being involved in the lives of our community, being involved in the lives of children, being involved in the lives of recovery, being involved in the lives of people who need justice. And that's just us. There's hundreds and millions, thousands and perhaps millions of ways to do church. We just want to do it this way. And so that's our purpose statement. But today I want to talk about what it means to be a disciple. And when I think about what it means to be a disciple, I'll start with this verse. These verses in Romans 10, verses 13 and 14. Paul wrote these, and it says this. Anyone who calls on the name of the Lord will be saved. Isn't that a great place to start? That no matter where you are today, no matter where you were yesterday, no matter where you will be tomorrow, if you call on the name of Jesus and ask Him to come into your life and to be your Savior, to be your Lord, He will absolutely do that without reservation. See, the great thing about the salvation equation is that Christ's part is already done. So that's why coming to Christ is so instantaneous. It doesn't have to go before a committee or a group of elders to decide if you're worthy. But because of what Christ has already done on the cross, when you say yes to Him, that relationship starts immediately. Isn't that wonderful? It goes on, but who can ask Him to save them unless they believe in Him? And that makes sense, doesn't it? In order to have a relationship with somebody, in order for me to put my trust in Christ, I need to believe in Him. In order for me to sit in this chair, I need to believe that it's going to hold me up. Oh, that's relief. In order to accept something, you have to believe in it. I had to believe that this chair was going to hold me up. The verse goes on, and how can they believe in him if they have never heard about him? That makes sense. I can't expect you to make a decision based on something that you've never heard about, that you never experienced, that you've never come to grips with. And then this last part, this is our part. And how can they hear about him unless someone tells them? See, that's our job. And that's the hard part. That's the hard part. Because the easy thing is to say, you know what? Because my wife loves Jesus, and my youngest son and his wife love Jesus, and baby Nora is growing up in a godly home, and because our oldest son knows Jesus, and his wife knows Jesus, and baby Cora is growing up in a godly home, and Caleb can now tell the Christmas story. Because they know Jesus, I'm good. So you know what? The heck with the rest of the world. I got mine. We're all spending eternity together. Whatever that looks like, me and the other eight in my immediate family are going to be with God forever. So you worry about yourself. That's not what the verse says. Scripture teaches us that we're to be about telling the world what has happened to us. For me, it happened in 1977. After much prayer, after my sister's best friend, Carrie Bambauer, now Carrie Clark, invited my sister to church, my sister started going to church. My sister started inviting me to church. I started going to church. Dave Toman, the youth pastor, who's now a senior pastor, spoke to me, encouraged me, loved me, played tennis with me, talked basketball with me, played touch football with me, poured into my life. After the young people at church surrounded me, encouraged me, loved me, even though I was not a church kid, then I found myself there in the last week of August, 1977, at Whiskeytown Lake at summer camp from Twin Lakes Church. And I gave my life to him. Because others decided that, you know what, even though I got mine, even though I'm secure in who I am in Christ, I'm going to reach out to that weird kid named Rick Floyd. And they did. And God used them to bring me to himself. And I gave my life to Christ on that Friday night in August. And that's what he's calling us to be about. To say, you know what, just because we're good, just because our family is good, that's not where he wants us to stop. He wants us to take those next steps in being a disciple. And that's what we're going to talk about today. But before we get to there, let's make sure everybody has a Bible. If you need a Bible, raise your hand. We'll get you one. And so that way you can follow along, because we want to make sure that we're studying God's Word, not what Rick says. And so if you need a Bible, raise your hand, and the guys will get you one. And before we get started, let's just spend some time in prayer. Father, thanks for this day. Thank you for the snow that is just penetrating and covering our world. God, thank you for that provision. God, I would continue to ask that as we go back and forth to church, that you keep us safe, that you watch over us. That God, that as we're right now here in worship, that you would speak to our hearts. That you would allow us to lay aside every other encumbrance, and we would be able to focus on what you have for us. God, I would ask that you would speak to the hearts of people in churches across our valley, that you would speak through pastors and leaders, and as they open your word, God, that you would bless that reading of the word and that bless the teaching of that word, and that they might be encouraged, and so that together, God, we can be about being the church of Lawson County and proclaiming your amazing message to this place that so desperately needs it. Father, thank you that we can spend some time now looking at your word and looking at what it means to be a disciple. We love you, and we look forward to what you have for us this morning. In your precious name I pray. Amen and amen. So, last March, we were at this thing called the District Leadership Development Conference, and it's a time when all the pastors from Northern California get together. We travel down to Vacaville, and they have a speaker, and the speaker was talking about this whole idea of discipleship, and was talking about that discipleship should be this thing where everybody can join in, because so often we get some wrong ideas about what it means to be a disciple. One of the wrong ideas we have is that everybody has to be exactly the same. We all have to fall in lockstep order to make sure that we're always doing the right thing at the right time and in the right way, or else we might not fit into what God has called us to be as a disciple. We also get the feeling that sometimes we're taught that, you know what, it's that you need to act like the leadership. You need to act like the ones that are more mature. And I would lovingly say those ideas aren't found in Scripture. What Scripture says about discipleship is that, you know what, it's available for all of us. And we're all going to enter into discipleship in different ways, even though there's some things that we probably should be about, because we're all different. I approach my relationship with Christ different than probably all of you, because I'm made differently than all of you. And even though God is this omniscient, all-knowing, all-powerful, everywhere, holy God, eternal God, he's also this personal God. And he wants to encounter me. He wants to engage me at who I am and what I need to grow in him. And so that's what I want to make sure that you guys get. If you get nothing else, I want you to make sure that you are all welcome into this journey called being a disciple. God desires to have you in this relationship. You don't need to be like everybody else. We don't need any more Pastor Conrads. Amen. We are all welcome. We're all welcome. So I got five just little things I want to talk about today. First is this. Take the next steps towards Jesus. Take the next steps towards Jesus. I would say that the little subtext says it better is this. By having a daily time with God, you can learn to listen to his voice and obey. God desires you. You. He wants you. He wants you to spend time with him. He wants you to come close to him. And I would say that spending time with God on a daily basis is the foundational piece of growing life in Christ. I would suggest to you that it's even more important than going to church. But church is good, right? I mean, church is great. We come to church and we worship God and we sing songs and we see each other that we haven't seen for a week, and we hear from the sermon and we laugh and we're encouraged and we walk out and we're just like edified. We're ready to go. And then what happens? You know what happens after church? It's called Tuesday. Right? Anybody had a Tuesday before? All of a sudden, the daughter that was so incredible is now all of a sudden a terror. What happened? On Friday, she brought home a report card. It was all A's. And on Tuesday, she's a monster. What happened to her? Fill in the blank. We've all got a name. Or our child is a prodigal. Or our spouse decided that, you know what, I'm not going to love you the way you need to be loved anymore. Or the boss has turned into a tyrant overnight. or my work colleagues are difficult to work with, or there's more month than money, and Tuesday happens. So what has to happen, folks, I believe with all my heart, is that you spend time with God so that He can get you through those Tuesdays. That He can take you Wednesday and Thursday and Friday and Saturday until you get to church again. See, spending time with God is the ability then to be able to learn how to feed yourself. And God desperately desires that you learn how to feed yourself. Church is important. Don't stop coming to church. But I believe it's so important that you can draw close to God. You take those next steps towards Him by having this daily time with God so you can learn to listen and hear His voice. My encouragement is that you start somewhere. That you start the process, that you find a place in your world where you can go and be alone with Him. Now, it might not be this gorgeous of a view. It might not be on a porch. But there's a place that you can find where you can go and be with God. I wish I could tell you that since 1977, I've had a daily quiet time with the Father, and I would be lying. But what I can tell you is that this does work. And over the last 10 years or so, my time with Him has become more and more and more and more consistent and holy. And I can say that as I've fallen deeper in love with Him, man, His voice has been stronger in my heart and in my soul and in my mind than ever before. It truly does work. Scripture has so much to say about this. Habakkuk says this, "I will climb up to my watchtower and stand at my guard post." It's important that you go to a place where you guard your life. It's important that you go to a place where you and God are discussing the things that will help guard your life. "There I will wait to see what the Lord says and how He will answer me." See, the great part about spending time with God is you don't have to be in a rush. Frequently what happens with me is when I start my time with God, I'm always concerned about the clock. It's just the way that my mind works. I'm just that guy. So I'm thinking, okay, now you know what? It's 6:30, and so I gotta be done at 7:10, so I can take a shower. So you know and I'm thinking this out, and then about 3 minutes in, the time thing is gone, because now I've entered into the presence of the Father. It's good to wait on Him. Luke shares this about Jesus. He says this, "But Jesus often withdrew to the wilderness for prayer." See, Jesus didn't wait, go from Sabbath to Sabbath. Oh, no, well, you know, it's not church time yet, so I can't go meet with... No, that's not how it worked. Jesus just went and spent time with His Father often. He's encouraging you to do it often, over and over and over again. Make this a habit in your life. He desires you so much. He looks and He says, "Man, there's nothing that would bring me greater joy than for you to come and just be with me." Mark says this about Jesus. "Before daybreak the next morning, Jesus got up and went out to an isolated place to pray." Now, before daybreak is a hard for me. And so I'm not sure, I'm pretty sure that it's not talking about the actual time, but it's just that Christ took that effort. He got up whatever time that you decide to get up, whether it's, you know, 4:30 in the morning or 4:30 in the afternoon, whether it's 8 o'clock in the morning or 8 o'clock at night, just be about getting up and going to that place where you can just pray. And then Christ on the Sermon on the Mount said these words. I love it in the Message. It's so powerful. Jesus says, here's what I want you to do. Find a quiet, secluded place. Doesn't it sound good? Doesn't a quiet, secluded place sound good? Especially for those of you who have small children at home. So you won't be tempted to role play before God. Just be there. Just be there. As simply and honestly as you can manage, the focus will shift from you to God, and you will begin to sense His grace. Last October, I was at a conference, and a woman was speaking on prayer. She's talking about having this quiet, secluded place. And shortly after that, Gwen and I went home, and we developed a prayer room. I have a prayer chair that, because I can do that because I don't have any children at home, so you know what, we got extra space. And because I used to do it in my chair in the living room, and the problem with that for me is next to the chair is the remote control. So that means that the TV can go on, and then I see the stuff on the counter that I was supposed to put away last night, and I need to do that. And Buster's running around, he wants a treat, or you know, he wants, you know, I never see the dishes, so that's good. But you know, so I'm distracted. I'm distracted by stuff. So I found a secluded place. And she was talking about that, you know what, that's available to everybody. She told a story of this woman who was a single mom living in a one-room apartment, and she had two children. So the children slept in the bedroom, and she slept on the couch in the living room or the family room or, you know, whatever it was. It's a one-room place. It's small. She says, you know what, I wasn't sure where my quiet place would be. I didn't know where that would be. I mean, because my bedroom is where the children would come. So one day I figured out, because I can't leave my kids alone, because I walk outside and go for a walk, they would destroy the place or each other. So she said, what I finally figured out is that after I put them to bed, I went to the bathroom, and I climbed into the empty tub, and I drew the shower curtain closed, and I had my secluded place. I tell you that story to tell you this. You can all find a secluded place. God wants you to come to that place and spend time with Him so you can begin to obey Him and hear His voice. Number two is this, live an attractive life. What I mean by that is this, prayerfully live a life empowered by the Holy Spirit and at all times giving glory to God. I love what Jesus said in the Sermon on the Mount. He says this, rain falls on the just and the unjust. And as you look at that picture, I dare you to find those who have a relationship with Christ and those who don't. It's not easily visible, is it? Just by a snapshot? Because we all experience some of the same things, don't we? We all have pain and sorrow and joy and heartache and gladness, don't we? It happens to all of us. And yet, what God is saying is that I want you to live out your life with pointing back to me. Live an attractive life that you know what, in spite of your life situation, in spite of your life circumstances, that you know what, that the glory is given back to me over and over and over again. Ephesians 3:15 and 21 says this, that according to the riches of His glory, He may grant you to be strengthened with power through His Spirit in your inner being. Is that true of you? Are you living this attractive life in our community where people see that even though stuff happens to you the same way that stuff happens to them, that, you know what, that Christ gives you power through His Holy Spirit to live out your life? so that Christ may dwell in your hearts through faith, that you being rooted and grounded in love. That's what you need to be rooted and grounded in is in love. Rooted and grounded in love. May have strength to comprehend with all the saints what is breadth and length and height and depth, and to know the love of Christ that surpasses knowledge, that we may be filled with the fullness of God. That word there, filled, means this. Means so filled up that you then have stuff to give to others. See, filled means that not just filled up to the top, it means filled to overflowing, so that you have enough of Christ that you can easily give Christ to others and not be drained of it yourself. That makes sense? I mean, anybody ever jump in a pool and then hug somebody else? What happens? You're so wet, you get the wet on them. And this is what they're saying here, is that Paul's saying that you should be so filled up with the things of God that it just overflows. That you're giving glory to God for what's going on in your life, even though your life sucks on Tuesday. Now to him who is able to do far more abundantly than all that we ask or think. That's like an 8-week sermon series right there, that little verse. According to the power at work within you, to him be the glory in the church and to Christ Jesus throughout all generations. See, the glory belongs to God. And as we live an attractive life, we point not to community church, we point not to Rick Floyd, we point to the person of Jesus Christ and the Heavenly Father and the Holy Spirit that works within us. That's who we point to. That's who our attractive life should be pointing to. Not to us, but to him. To him. Third, love those outside the faith. Oh, man. Well, you guys been on Facebook this week? No, I don't want to. I don't want to love those outside the faith. Talk about what God is doing in your life and gracefully meet the needs of others. Oh, man, do I really have to? So every conversation becomes an opportunity for you to share with others the love of Christ. Every encounter becomes an opportunity for you to share what God is doing in your life and to point them to the person of Christ on the cross. John 13:35 is one of my favorite verses. I love this. He's talking about what it means to be a disciple, and he finishes Jesus finishes his little mini sermonette by saying this: by this all men know that you are my disciples, that you have love for one another. It doesn't mean that you're right. See, folks, the good thing about having life in Christ and knowing Scripture, I know I'm right. I know that marriage is between a man and a woman. I know that life begins at conception. I know that all people are created equal, and I don't need to go on a march to prove it. But me being right, I don't need to tell the world that I'm right. We don't need to tell the world we're right. What we do need to do is love them. Because I would suggest that when we get on Facebook and we proclaim how right we are doing much less about bringing people to Christ than pushing them away. And it's hard, because I'm right. I am. I was driving to church today. Gwen was in the car. We're driving up Paul Bunyan. You know, we're at Five Way. Is that what it's called, Five Way? I've only been here 8 years. I don't know all the terms yet. So Five Way, right? Is that Five Way? When we make a left, we're going up. Is that Paul Bunyan that goes past the casino? Is that Paul Bunyan that goes past the casino? Mickey, why are you laughing at me? Okay. So I'm driving up Paul Bunyan. Gwen's in the car. And I swear to you, there's, a, I mean, and it's dumping snow, and no one's done the roads yet, and so it's slushy and nasty, and so we're going slow, and we're driving up, and we come around, and then there's this woman, there's this person, and she's parked in the middle of Paul Bunyan, this person is parked in the middle of Paul Bunyan, and they're wiping their snow off the car. And it's obvious that she has just come from the casino, and I'm thinking, huh, wasn't the snow on your car in the casino parking lot? Why did you wait till you pulled onto Paul Bunyan in the middle of the road? It's hard to love people that aren't always bright, isn't it? And my wife, being way nicer than me, she says, oh, but she's doing the right thing now. Oh, okay. And she was. But I mean, you know what? If I wanted to, I could have jumped out of the car and said, what are you doing? But it's far better for one of us who knows this woman to engage her about things of Christ, to engage her about things of God, and to bring her to a place where she gives her life over to Christ. Rather than me telling her that she's wrong, that would have done nothing. I was wrong there. God calls us to love each other. There's no advantage to being right without love. There's just none. Paul writes in 1 Corinthians, now God gives us many kinds of special abilities, and there are different kinds of service to God. All of you together form the one body of Christ, and each of you is a separate and necessary part of it. We're all necessary. Because as I looked at that woman who was there, I didn't know her. But one of you might. And if we're to reach the community of Lassen County with the message of Jesus Christ, it takes all of us to impact all of our different and varied worlds, to go and show them love, because we're all in this together. We aren't called to do this to the entire community all by ourselves. Not me, not Steve, not Rick, not Randy, not Janelle, not Sherry, not the elders, not the deacons, not the deaconesses, not the Sunday school teachers, not the people in justice. None of us are called to do it by ourselves. We're one body, and we're called in to be about going out together and reaching our community. My world is different than your world. Next is multiply your life in others. Commit to community always with a hand forward and a hand back. God desires that we are in a place where people know us and where we know people. That we can share our heartaches, our joys, our sorrows with those who care about us. And the whole idea of a hand forward and a hand back is that means that sometimes I have to help somebody else up. Some people have to help me up. It happens both ways. You know, there was a time, I think it was in August of 2013, where I had the right answer for somebody. Most of the time, it's people having the right answer for me. God desires that you're in relationship with each other. I love my small group. We go every week. And because of that, I know what's going on in the Browns' life, and I pray for Russ and Darla all the time. I pray for the Fosters, and they pray for me. Jeff and Emily Lomas are in our small group, and because of that, I've seen over 300 pictures of Tucker. Thank goodness she's gone from every day to every week now, so there'll be less of him. We've got to know Jeff Lomas's sister and her husband, Shane and Jacqueline, and the Hewitts, and the Hammonds. And we share our lives together. We break bread together. We study God's word together. We pray for each other. There's nothing like being in community. And so I would encourage you to be in community, to commit to being in community, being helped and helping. Because see, you were not created to be a one-man band. You weren't created to do life on your own. The writer of Hebrews says this: let us think of ways to motivate one another to acts of love and good works, and let us not neglect our meeting together, as some people do, but encourage one another. Encourage one another. Especially now that the day of his returning is drawing near. In Galatians chapter 6, verses 1 to 3, Paul writes this: live creatively, friends. If someone falls into sin, forgivingly restore them, saving your critical comments for yourself. Amen. I think he's talking about Facebook there. Anyway, sorry. You might be needing forgiveness before the day's out. I will. Before the day's out, Gwen will have to forgive me. Because there's more forgiveness between her and I than anybody else. Because you know what? I spend more time with her than anybody else. So she sees me not only at my best, but she sees me at my worst. Stoop down and reach out to those who are oppressed. Share their burdens. My question to you is simply this: whose burdens are you sharing? Are you stooping down? And so complete Christ's law. If you think you are too good for that, you are badly deceived. I love that. If you think you're above stooping down and sharing each other's burdens, you're wrong. Because you'll need forgiveness before the sun sets. So why don't you just be in a place where you can admit that, where people can pray for you and encourage you and build you up and allow you to become more of the person of God that he desired you to be. And then lastly, live with an open hand. Keenly aware that God is the giver of all good gifts, live a life of stewardship and service. It's hard to live like this, because there might be days when I have nothing. It's hard to say, you know what, God, all I have is yours, and I'm just waiting for you to fill me up and give me what I need for the day. It's much easier to live like this, isn't it? To hold on to what I got. It's mine. My family's good, so why would I care about the rest of the world? I have enough resources, so why would I share? I'm going to hold on to what's mine. I've earned it, dang it! But Scripture says, live like this. James, the half-brother of Christ, says it this way: whatever is good and perfect is a gift coming down to us from the Father, who created all the lights in the heavens. He never changes or casts a shifting shadow. Isn't that good that he never changes? Because see, I change all the time. I just do. Yet God, who will provide all that I need, never changes. And so I can trust him more than I can trust myself. My wife can trust him more than she can trust me. This church can trust him more than it can trust me. And that's a good thing for me. It's a good thing for Gwen. It's a good thing for you. That God sees what you need and he will meet those needs every step along the way. Christ said it this way: so don't worry about these things, saying, what will we eat? What will we drink? What will we wear? These things dominate the thoughts of unbelievers, but your heavenly Father already knows all your needs. See, it's easy to live with open hands when you believe that God knows all that you need. Thanks, John. Seek the kingdom of God above all else and live righteously, and he will give you everything you need. Trust him. Give your life over to Him. Give your stuff over to Him. Give your time over to Him. Give your joy over to Him. Give your sorrow over to Him. And allow Him this year to just pour into your life. And trust me, your life will be overflowing with the goodness and grace of our Heavenly Father. He sees what you need, and He will meet that need each and every moment of each and every day. The worship team can come up, and just in conclusion, I just want to remind you of the five things we talked about today. Live life with an open hand. Multiply your life and others by being involved in community. Love those outside the faith. Live an attractive life, being empowered by the Holy Spirit. And take the next steps towards Jesus by having an ongoing, consistent, quiet time with our Heavenly Father. So as the worship team comes and gets ready to play our last song, I'm just going to invite you to come. If you need prayer, Tim and Emily, will you guys be over there? So Tim and Emily carry on. They're part of our Celebrate Recovery leadership team. They'll be there to help with prayer. Doug and Marcy, can you guys be over there? Doug's one of our elders, and Doug and Marcy will be there to help if you need prayer, or you can just come forward. You can come forward and just pray. Get 2017 off to a great start. I'd hope that you take these sermon notes. I'm not asking you to make any big life-changing revelation. I'm just asking you to say, you know what, man, what do I need? What's one thing do I need to get better at? And just take steps. And maybe what am I doing well, and how can I do that just a little bit better? So that as you look back in January of 2018, you can look back and say, man, you know what? Those decisions I made in January 2017, to move from being kind to being generous, from realizing that I've been forgiven much, so I'm going to give much, or maybe one of these little habits, that it's made a difference. I'm more the person that God desires me to be 12 months from that sermon series that was at Community Church in January. So come and either get prayer or pray to God. But let's stand and close our service together.